I appreciate you taking the time to speak with me. I'm a really big fan of what you do, man. I got to just come straight out and say it. Right off the top, I'm a drummer as well. So I'm definitely just a huge fan of your techniques, man. So definitely, I want to dig into the technical side of your stuff a little bit during this, if that's cool.
Yeah, absolutely. No worries.
Awesome.
That's awesome.
Right off the bat, I noticed the Rush. Is that an LP on your wall?
Yeah, man. It's a Hemisphere's 40th anniversary LP. My dad got it for me. It's a nice picture disc of the album cover. And man, if you wanted to talk Rush stuff, I got, oh man, I should send you this, like just send you a picture of it when we're done. But my dad just got me this. It was like a Government of Canada issued thing with like the Rush merch company. That's like, it's like a platinum record of theirs. It's a picture of them from the Farewell to Kings days. Ooh. It's so well placed in terms of symmetry. And then it's got all their records on the top, and then it's got their studio records, and then their live and whatever other stuff. It's like goes right above my bar, and it looks so cool. And I just got it a couple days ago. So I love Rush. I know you do too.
I definitely do, man. Yeah, and I mean, even just watching you perform, you know, you're often wearing Rush t-shirts, be it in your lessons or in your live performances.
Oh, yeah.
Was that one of the first groups that really stood out to you in terms of rock and roll?
No, it wasn't, because like, well, in terms of me being a drummer and really gravitating towards a rock and roll band as opposed to a metal band, I got into Rush maybe like 10 years ago or something like that. So kind of late in life, but I got into them in a big way.
Yeah.
And, but rock and roll bands though, I was into rock bands like since I was just a boy. Like my dad used to have a jukebox like before I was born. So my brother and I, when we were old enough, we would just like push the buttons because we wanted to push buttons and hear the whirring sound that it would make. And then we just danced the music. And my dad's like, this is Guns N' Roses. This is Aerosmith. This is Led Zeppelin. And we're like, oh, cool. I love this song or whatever. So I was into rock bands from an early age, but in terms of like me being an already established drummer and gravitating towards a particular rock band, Rush was definitely that, where I was like, oh my gosh, this is like the most heavy metal sounding drumming ever heard in my life, you know? So yes, in a way they were my first like real rock band that I absolutely fell in love with. Yeah.
Did you ever get the chance to see them perform before they retired?
Yeah, three times. Nice. Yes.
That's incredible. Yeah. Was there any standout points from those shows? I'm sure he probably did solos at all of them, Neil Peart.
Yeah, they honestly, just being in their presence was all standout for me, for sure. You know, having the right combination of, you know, weed and a little bit of drink or whatever made for a good night where I was like, you know, really feeling it and really connected to the music. But man, like I just air drum my heart out at those shows. And the Time Machine one was really cool. I think it was where they did their modern. Oh, they did. What was it? They did. I'm having trouble like keeping track of which one was which. There was like R40. There was Time Machine. Whichever one I saw where they stripped down the stage and their last song they played, they made it look like it was the high school gym. Or whatever.
I think I might have seen a video of that.
They went backwards in time where it's like their more recent stuff. And then when they did 2112, like their backline, their amps and the drum kit and all that stuff was made to look like it was back in the 70s. And then they played like some like a demo before Neil Peart was even in the band, kind of thing, when John Rutsey was on drums. And then you know, there were people just, you know, change. Alex's amp went to like a small little trainer amp. Getty's bass was like, you know, and it was all just made to look like a high school gym. And then there was like a disco ball, like they were playing the high school dance. And it was just real, really cool. They paid homage to their backwards in time to their trajectory, which was really cool.
That's so badass. Yeah, definitely a group that will be missed. And, you know, Neil Peart obviously will be missed tremendously. Rest in peace. We're sort of talking about technical drumming and really that aspect of it. In terms of you, you're mostly self-taught. I know that you took a couple of lessons when you first got started. But were you really technical when you first started teaching yourself, or did that come in later for you?
I was overly technical before I should... I tried to run before walking, so to speak. So drum wise, because I did take a couple lessons before, like off the get go, but I largely just ignored whatever the person was trying to tell me, and I practiced a lot, but. And like now that I'm a teacher, I can like, you know, and I have all this like hindsight and retrospect after 22 years of playing that practice doesn't always make perfect. Practice makes permanent sometimes too. So you practice so much, but like I was practicing technique wise, you know, the wrong stuff where it's like I would have, you know, but that's not necessarily a bad thing because it's more important to like do and play and fail and all this stuff.
Yeah.
Cause that's how you gain experience and knowledge and all this stuff. So, I was always collecting musical ideas in that I was listening to lots of music, trying to do what the drummers were doing. And then I started playing lots with different people, which is also very important, because that's kind of how you get, that's where you want to end up is playing with people, playing with bands. And the challenges that come with that. So I was doing all the right stuff. And then eventually I started to hit walls where it's like I could only go a certain sort of speed. And then maybe I had like certain pains in my hand. I'm like, oh, this shouldn't be happening. And especially with the advent, with the internet being a thing that was at my control all of a sudden, because like when I started, it really wasn't. I started like 97, 98. Yeah. So it was just sort of about to pop off. So I was like slightly pre-internet starting drumming. And then the more experts that I was listening to, they would say, well, you shouldn't have pain in your hands. You should, you know, if you're hitting a wall with speed, that is because of this thing or that thing. And so I was like, oh, okay, well, like I need to go back to the basics and really strip down things and pull it apart and put it back together again, because I've been playing so long the way, you know, this incorrect way, so to speak, or where it's just like limited my vocabulary in order to express what I wanted to say. And that's how I tell it to students, where it's like, you know, I know this technique stuff is boring, but you're going to thank me someday because this is only a means to an end. So you can express what idea you're going for in the best possible way. You know, the technique isn't a musical idea. It's just a technique. What's important is that you're listening to music and that you're engaged and excited about music and about drumming and stuff like that. So yeah, I was always technical. And I'm still always trying to, you know, I'm always trying to look at things with a beginner's mind. And that's kind of what I like about you. Like I just started listening to you a couple days ago because our mutual friend, Tommy Campbell, put us in touch. And, I started listening to, I listened to maybe about 5 or 6 of your podcasts, though. You did the one you did with, George Stramalopoulos. I really, really liked.
Oh, thanks.
That was great. The one you did with Tommy was awesome. Gene Simmons, the Melvins, all this stuff. I like how you ask a question and then you basically let the person give an answer and you don't try and overly insert yourself. You just sort of stop and listen and you're pretty like, you have that beginner's mind as well. I feel you know, which I think is a great thing for anybody to have, especially when it comes to an art form, because after 22 years of drumming, I still feel like I am a beginner. I still feel like there's so much I have to learn. I still feel that this instrument has so much to teach me, and I love how humbling it is. It's great.
Definitely. It's always that journey. Well, and first of all, thank you so much. I really appreciate that. And that definitely means a lot that you, for that feedback. And it sort of reminds me of this song that I heard, and you likely heard it. It's called My First Song by Jay-Z. And in the very beginning, he plays a clip of Biggie Smalls talking about how every time he goes in the studio, he does it like it's his first song and his first recording. And that's really how he achieves his greatness. So it's interesting that you say that. So when you say back to basics, is that meaning like the rudiments, the technical stuff, and to sort of get those mechanics rolling?
Yeah, rudiments, technical stuff, and then using physics and nature to your advantage. Things like the free stroke is one of the things that I talk to people about, where it's you have the stick at a full 90 degrees, and then you throw it down, and then it crashes into the surface, and then it bounces back up out of its own inertia. So you literally don't need to pull it back up. It's the exact same. It's the exact same idea as throwing down a basketball. The basketball gets velocity, crashes into the ground, bounces back up, and then all you do is really, catch it on its the top part of its arc, of its inertial arc, and then you just throw it back down again, and it bounces back up. Like these are like fundamental revelations that I had that took me years to get, but they're so useful. And back to basics, and that's what I mean in terms of motion, sticking, and it's all very helpful. And there is a reason it's on page one of anything that you're doing, because if it's so easy, then people say, oh, it's easy. So I'm like, okay, well, if it's so easy, show it to me, play it properly. Let me see you do it.
Yeah.
And oftentimes they cannot do it. They don't know those things well enough. And, it's just like learning your ABCs, and then you learn a word, and then you put a word to a sentence, and then a sentence to a paragraph. It's a similar kind of a trajectory, which I kind of had to go back and redo, but it's just one more footnote in the whole conversation we're having about how drums and music in general has still so much to teach you forever,
Yeah, absolutely, man. And I can totally relate it to even to vocals. It's like if you're singing in an incorrect way and you're really just going for it, you can hurt your voice. But if you can learn to technically sing in the right way, you could deliver that sound properly while not hurting your voice. So, that's really interesting to think about. Talking about some of your other earlier influences, of course, Slipknot is one that was big for you. Joey Jordison on the drums. When listening to that stuff before really learning the rudiments, was that easy for you to recreate, or was it a struggle at first?
The hands were easier for me to do, and then the feet, because there was double kick, I rented a double kick, and I was trying to emulate whatever it was I was hearing, and I couldn't do it. I knew instinctively that I still had work to do with other stuff, with keeping a 4/4 beat, or just keeping all the limbs moving, the kick, snare, and hat, basically in its simplest form, to keep all that going and get better at that. And then one day I just sort of had a revelation where I was playing enough and I understood how double bass worked just in my mind. I was able to grok it. I was able to understand, what the left foot was doing in relation to the right, in relation to the hands. And then I just went out and straight up bought one. Or my dad probably bought me a double kick pedal where I was like, okay, I get this now. I know I can just step in and use it. And then I started to just sort of work from the ground up of like not being able to play that fast, or at least not for very long without tiring out. Mm-hmm. But, it's all about the repetitions, really, and the mileage. And that's when I started with that. So, Joey, especially, because I was right at that perfect target age when nu metal kind of came around.
Right.
That was my gateway. So I'm not even the biggest fan, of nu metal in general. It's because there's too many, gimmicks attached to it. I like gimmicks. But not necessarily the kind that I now have a taste for. So, but back then it made perfect sense that I was I was 12 and I was, I was listening to heavy metal, and Slipknot was in everybody's face. MTV, Much Music and all that stuff was going. And, they had a look and the production was great. I spent a lot of time learning Slipknot songs. The first live performance I ever did on the drums was at a talent show when I was in grade 10, 9 or 10, where I played just from memory the song Sick off of the self-titled record, which I still think is a fantastic album.
Yeah.
And I remember my heart pounding out of my chest. I was like, that was the coolest feeling I've ever experienced, and I want more of it so badly. And so Slipknot was a benchmark for sure for drumming. It did make sense to me on some levels, and then other ones I really had to slow down and keep up with and try and understand. And then eventually I ended up meeting with Joey. I ended up meeting him, and not just as a fan, but as I hung out with him for a full day.
Wow.
at a when I first joined 3 Inches of Blood, he was doing a music video as their drummer because I was filling in. I wasn't the permanent guy yet. And they needed a drummer for a music video. And so we were on our way through Des Moines, Iowa on the first tour I ever did with 3 Inches of Blood. And we spent a full day while all the guys were together just like shooting a music video in some room somewhere. And I got to just hang out. And I was 21. And I was like, oh my God, like I really had to, you know, I probably punished him. I think I gave him my band CD or whatever, which I later found out, you know, and through time understood, like, oh yeah, well, you know, that's nice, but they don't really listen to that stuff, or it's like, that's not how you make friends or whatever. So I'm like, okay, but he was really nice, took pictures with me. And then 3 Inches of Blood ended up going out on tour with Slipknot for about 8 shows where we were playing stadiums. And I got to see him night after night, and he was so great and gracious, and we would always hang out afterwards. He was really cool about that. And then we did Mayhem Fest in 2010, and he was playing drums for Rob Zombie, and he would bring out some. He would come out, watch us play, and everything. And I just thought, man, this is so great what this guy did for heavy metal drumming. And, you know, even though I didn't keep up with it forever in terms of always being a fan of Slipknot and always trying to emulate their music, I cannot deny what that guy did for me and countless other drummers out there as well.
Definitely, man. He's totally a staple. And when you mention that time frame and sort of the age range of a lot of these people, you can see the impression that he's made on the bands that sort of came afterwards. And it's interesting, too, because he's always synonymous with Slipknot, of course, but, you know, like you mentioned, he was playing with you guys or with the group before you started. He was playing with Korn at one point. He was playing with Rob Zombie, like you said. So it's interesting. Would you say it's more common for a drummer in the major circuit to be in one group or to sort of bounce around like he does?
I would say in general, bounce around unless you landed the dream gig or something, or maybe playing in a bunch of bands isn't on your priority list or your value system. Like maybe you have a family at home and you can only afford to go on tour with one band, and maybe you make enough money doing that. But in general, I think drummers seem to just really like drumming and drumming in different contexts with different bands, different groups. And that's fun and interesting to them. And it's fun and interesting to me too. I always have a bunch of projects on the go when I'm not doing my main gig with Revocation. And so I would definitely say that drummers, they like to get around by and large, you know, but not because they're vain or anything like that, but because I think they're genuinely interested in drums across the spectrum, be it rock or metal or funk or R&B or jazz, you know. Yeah. Absolutely. I've met some very diverse players over the years where I'm like, geez, I can't believe it. This person can do jazz. They can do jazz, or they grew so hard they can do funk gigs, but they're playing in like a death metal band as well. That's fascinating.
That's crazy. Yeah.
Yeah.
Is there any styles that you struggle to play because you have so much experience? And I mean, it's just insane.
I mean, there's, I would say I struggle to play it authentically. Absolutely. You know,
what does that mean exactly? Jazz?
Jazz and Latin music. You know, I can play those patterns, but as George Carlin once said, it's not enough to know what notes to play. You have to know why they need to be played.
I like that.
Me too. And I'm sure he probably heard it from a blues musician. I'm pretty sure it's probably an old saying, but I feel like it stands true to those genres specifically as well, but definitely to metal as well. So I can play that stuff. I have jazz sort of coordination chops and stuff like that. But that's a kind of art form that you really live from what I've noticed, where you've grown up on jazz, or you have a regular intake of jazz music. And I feel it's the highest level of drumming because it's so musical and it's so technical as well. And I have no issue saying that, because I don't know, it kind of just to me seems self-evident, you know, these people who are just absolutely unbelievable, you know, going from the 20s up until whatever, the 70s, 60s.
Yeah.
So some of the jazz guys, Louis Belson, Buddy Rich, mm-hmm. Max Roach, Roy Haynes, some of the best session musicians and all this stuff. It's, you know, it's not just that they could blow really great chops or anything like that, but they also played music that was right, the drum parts that were right for the music, yeah. And made you feel something. And yeah, so yeah, that being said, when I really want to improve on stuff, I'll try and work on those kinds of patterns, just because that's so far outside of my normal everyday diet of drumming, mm-hmm. that, you know, I try and turn those weaknesses into strengths. You know,
that's really interesting. Yeah, I like that. So you're always trying to exercise those muscles. You're not really satisfied once you've reached the peak of something, so to speak.
Yeah, and also there is no peak, really. I suppose there is, but
to a degree,
it's funny.
There's no peak.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because, you know, it's funny. Like you might master something, but then you neglect it for a few years, and then, you know, coming back to it, all of a sudden it's hard again. Or, you know, you might have mastered something in a particular context, but then when you put it through a different filter or do it in a different sort of way, it becomes harder all of a sudden. That's mm-hmm. That's what's so great about, like, you maybe master a rudiment, but can you play it between three or four or more different surfaces while you're doing this on your feet, while, you know, playing the right hand louder than the left, and then playing, you know, there's so many variables that you add in that all of a sudden there's no, you know, you thought you were at the base of Mount Everest, you thought you were at the top of Mount Everest, and all of a sudden you're like, oh no, there's more to go.
I'm a third up,
exactly. But yeah, so that's how I feel about that.
That's crazy, man. So in terms of listening to music now, and especially around while you're creating, because I love to ask musicians this, what do you listen to? Does it affect you to listen to drums, or do you try to, like, because I know it's hard not to find drums in music, but I guess certain types of drums, does that affect you, or is it anything goes?
Pretty much anything goes, in that you can really take an idea that is not in a heavy metal band and apply it to a heavy metal song in a really effective and authentic way. Like, you can take a pop pattern or a disco beat or a Latin beat or something like that and throw it into a song, and it still fits really well. That's what I always loved about the Dillinger Escape Plan. They were always one of my favorite bands, and their drummer Chris Penny, when he was inventing this subgenre of heavy metal drumming back in like the mid 90s, mm-hmm. he would take Latin patterns and linear patterns, and he would apply them to some of this really crazy music. And it didn't sound like a Latin pattern forced into a song for the sake of it. It mm-hmm. sounded like it really fit, and it gave a really fresh and unique spin on whatever they were trying to do. So I'm just saying that as a context to tell you that there's so much that you can draw from when you're writing songs. I don't have my ear to the ground, my thumb on the pulse with all new music that comes out these days. And in fact, I find myself looking even just deeper into the past and, you know, digging deeper into bands I might not have heard of from the 70s or 80s. Or metal bands that maybe only have one good record and then they never did anything again because they never had a fair shot or something like that.
Yeah.
I like discovering that kind of stuff as well, because ultimately that's, you know, you kind of have to do some of that digging to try and find out where you're at now, where things came from, you know. Like, musically, you see how jazz ran into R&B, led into rock and roll, led into metal, and so on. You know, that's all important stuff. So
yeah.
I find that to be very useful when it comes to writing new stuff, when I just sort of look backwards a little bit and try and see, okay, well, how did I get here today? Who did I really like? Who did Rush like, you know?
Mm-hmm.
That kind of thing is interesting to me. And then I'll listen to that.
The influence.
Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. There's a broader sort of scope that you could, that's really helpful and useful to sort of take in, I think, even if you're trying to write new and modern music. Yeah.
It's totally true. I even saw in one of your drum teaching videos, you were talking about a certain African drum rhythm and how Opeth and many other groups have used it. And it was really cool to see you actually demonstrate how it can be used in a metal song and stuff like that. What are you doing right now with COVID-19? Are you still teaching at all? Is there any online or are you on hold?
Yeah, I'm doing online teaching. I have a student after later today. I got four tomorrow. Wow. And yeah, and I got my electronic drums right next to me here. Hmm. And yeah, I've been doing that to just, you know, to make some money, and it's also fun. I enjoy it.
Yeah.
I think it's a good way to give back. Mm-hmm. And while still getting something out of it at the same time. And what I also get out of it is a sort of perspective on my own playing, because you really know something as well as you can explain it to somebody. Mm. You know, it's interesting to, you might instinctively know something, but can you break it down from a bunch of different ways and make some of these core principles understandable to a beginner or to a novice person? And, you know, So I've always appreciated when people are able to do that with me. If I'm maybe not getting it, what they're saying, they know enough about what they're doing they're able to explain it to me or an audience in a different way in which we can understand it. And, you know, that's because they know it so well and they know it from so many different angles that they can just change their perspective on a whim. Hmm. And make it digestible for people. And I find that really
easy.
No. And that's one of the things I like about teaching is I'm like, oh, okay, this person's not getting it. How can I help them to understand it for themselves? Yeah. And, you know, there's different elements, you know, some people like to see things written out. Some people like to hear it. Some people like to see it being played or whatever. You know, maybe it's a combination of all these things that helps them get it, but you need to put in the work yourself. There's no getting around that, but yeah, I've always liked that about just instruction in general, that dynamic. So,
for sure. What's it been like in terms of teaching online? Did you ever do online teaching before the virus, or is this new to you?
It's a little bit new. I have done some Skype lessons before, and I took some Skype lessons before.
Okay.
I mostly did things in person, but I sort of just adapted in that, like, I just have a better setup where I got this. Software called Loopback.
Yeah, I've heard
of that. Yeah. It's for music. It's actually really helpful because, like with Skype, like we're talking now, I can just take a direct signal from my drum brain and feed it directly to you. So, you know, it's just coming right in and coming out to you. So it's not getting picked up by a microphone. You're not hearing the taps that I'm doing on the surfaces of the pads. All you're hearing is just the raw audio that's coming out of it.
As if you sent the file.
Yeah, exactly. But it's just happening in real time, and it's being routed right to whichever application you want. So that was a good game changer for just sort of upping the quality of the lessons and the presentation that I'm trying to give to people as well.
That's so cool, man. Well, I'm really glad you're doing that, definitely. To close it out, I just want to know what's next for you. Do you have any solo music maybe that's going to drop, maybe Revocation? What's in the cards?
Yeah, so we're working on new material.
Okay.
And we sort of always work this way as long as I've been playing with Revocation, where, you know, I'm over here in Vancouver, Canada, and Dave is now living in New York. And we have this like general back and forth going on where, you know, he'll send me a file, I'll send him back a drum demo, and then we'll talk about it on the phone or on Skype. And he'll say, hey, I thought this was great. I think this, maybe we need to change this. And then we'll just sort of sit and work out the specifics of it, and then I'll just do another draft, you know, keep the things that we wanted to keep, and then we just try and redo something again, and then send it back and just come, you know, you do some back and forths with just file sharing and everything like that. And that's always sort of worked for us in terms of just getting a writing process going. And
Badass. Yeah,
it's cool. And then I have a project with the old guitar player for 3 Inches of Blood, my old bandmate, Justin Hagberg. That just came out. It's called Ritual Dictates. It's on Artifact Records, and that came out a month ago, and the response seems to be really good. People seem to really dig it. It's got some elements of 3 Inches of Blood in it in parts, but it's mostly just sort of straight ahead, like, you know, death metal of, you know, kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And I play in a band called Zimmer's Hole as well. And we're writing new music, and I've got another project going on with this Italian guitar player who I'm a big fan of. So there's no shortage of irons in the fire for me, musically speaking. So this is actually an okay time to be devoting time and energy to that kind of stuff.
Yeah, I completely agree. And where can people find you online?
So my Instagram is @AshRevocation, @_Revocation. Facebook, there's like a Fans for Ash Pearson page that I curate, because mostly my other Facebook page is for friends and whatever. And then Ash Pearson 2, I think, is my Twitter. And you can hit me up at ashpearsonlessons.com if you want to take a lesson. And then I got some additional info and discography and blog and all that kind of stuff at my website, ashpearson.com. So
beautiful. Ash Pearson, thank you so much.
Thanks, Cassius. Thanks for having me.